the Insanely Dangerous Retro Pod Show is proud to be part of the Scene Stealers Podcast Network and their international convention agency, who have a top draw roster of bodacious 80s and 90s stars who are ready to attend your next Comic Con or any other kick-ass event. Do not be dangerously insane. Check them out now and you will not regret it. Bosh. Right, pod fans, on with the show.
Stand by. You're live in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Hello yet again and welcome to the Insanely Dangerous Retro Pod Show. We are the world's most fearsome fighting team. We feel the magic and hear the roar as we celebrate, venerate and ejaculate the very best of times, aka the 1980s and the 1990s. It's a real wacky show where anything goes. Each week, we leap back and forward in time, striving to put right what once went wrong, and hoping that the next leap will be the leap home. Joining me on this 50p shop calamity clusterfuck, where Paul Young lays his hat, is a stoic 1980s encyclopedia that just happens to be the inspiration for Roxette's third best song. He is the bastard love child of Arne Anderson and the ginger bloke from Mask. He's amazing. He's fantastic. Wherever there is trouble, he'll be there. Welcome to tonight's show, Dangerous Dave.
Good evening, Gaz. Here we are again, back for another week of Retrofield Chat.
Yes, indeed, Danger. It is another week. There is more Retrofield Chat, and we're here like a red car and a blue car having a confectionery-based contest. How are you?
I'm very good. I'm very well, very happy, yes. I don't know why. I'm assuming because it's not a Thursday and it's a weekend and I'm more awake and I'm more alive. They coming off of a Thursday, long day working. Now I feel like I've been out and I've done some stuff and I'm like, yes, let's do this. Let's smash this out.
Oh, brilliant. Well, good. I'm glad one of us is feeling positive.
Yes.
That's good then. That's all right.
Plenty of sugar as well. So that's
all. Yeah, I've had lots of caffeine and it's having the opposite effect. So I was going to say I need a little bit of Dange juice, but I don't know. That means completely something different, doesn't it?
Good as well.
Oh, whoops. Yeah, don't want to put that in a can. Okay.
Wow. Shall we just get on with the show? Our last question.
Let's leave that there. Let's park that and then put a clamp on it. Okay.
So guys, what are we talking about this week?
Oh, well, this week we're talking about the American action drama television series Baywatch. Created by Michael Burke, Douglas Schwartz and Gregory J. Bonin, who produced the show throughout its 11-season run, the series focuses on both the professional and personal challenges faced by the characters, portrayed by a large rotating ensemble cast as they patrol the beaches of Los Angeles County in California. The show was cancelled after its first season on NBC, but survived through syndication and later became the most watched television series in the world, with an estimated weekly audience of 1.1 billion, despite consistently negative critical reviews, earning it a reputation as a pop cultural phenomenon and a frequent source of allusion and parody. The show ran in its original title and format from 1989 to 1999, and then from 1990 to 2001, with the setting change and large cast overhaul known as Baywatch Hawaii. It spawned a spin-off series, Baywatch Nights, which aired for two seasons from 95 to 97 and a 2017 feature film adaption, whilst also providing a launchpad for some of the 90s best-known stars. And you know what, pod fans? The show and its main man, the mighty Hoff, they have this almost symbiotic relationship in that the David poured a lot of his personal wealth into it, or so I hear.
Yes.
And a lot of his time into the show. And in turn, it also extended his career into and beyond the show's run. So
it did.
I understand if you're not a fan of the show, that's okay.
It's not okay.
But if you're not a fan of the Hoff, then you need to get lost and you're going to hell. Because, yeah.
Absolutely.
That guy is just a constant source of joy and amusement and wonder. And maybe he shouldn't be, but he is.
Yes.
Right. Okay. I was just there thinking like, oh, I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to say all this. And I can feel my throat getting scratchier and scratchier. Okay. So, give me a second.
Okay. Yeah. Find some information for it.
Yes. No. Dave juice, please.
No. won't stretch across the island.
I thought for this episode, what we could do, I could interrogate the only person I've ever met who proudly boasts of their love for this show and find out exactly why we should all be avidly binging this still in 2022 without using the words boobs or six packs. So, Dangerous, breasts and abdominals aside, what makes this such a smashing show?
Well, I mean, for me, based on the fact that in the 80s, after Knight Rider, it ended in 87, which was, you know, I was still gutted when I heard that the fourth season was the last one, even though it wasn't the best season. 2 years later, in Pop's Baywatch, and I'm like, Michael Knight is back on TV, but this time he's a lifeguard. That's amazing. I just thought I'm just picturing, like, on a Saturday night watching it in, like, I'm trying to think, well, I think we were in Chelmsford at the time, so sat in Chelmsford just like watching these larger than life characters running around on the beach, where you're not in a country where you can actually do that, so you're just it kind of like your mind boggles and you're like, what is this? Look at all this sun and the sand, and it's wow, people are drowning and they're being saved, it's amazing. And then there's plot character twists as well, and I'm like, yeah, that first season, even though it was not as, I don't think people say it's as popular as what when it came back in 91, but that first season just hooked me in and I was like, this is awesome. I love this.
So yeah, it was like a lot of the things that people from our generation, we immediately hooked in by larger than life character, you know, especially you've got a name like the Hoff.
Yeah.
You do have, again, it's this, we were hooked on America.
Yes.
This great foreign land far away from here that do things just a little bit different than the rest of us.
Yes.
I mean, I you're absolutely right regards to, I mean, you couldn't have a Baywatch UK, could you?
Oh God, no. Where would that even be? Bournemouth Beach is probably the closest kind of sandy beach you could do it on, but you wouldn't really want to do it in Bournemouth, would you?
No. And and also, and you especially couldn't have done it in 1989.
No.
Crikey, O'Reilly. No, we were still very much, they still very much had like an older mentality in 1989. So and whilst we were happy with that, I can totally see where you're coming from. All of a sudden you're just like, well, this is brand new and fresh and exciting, which is, I think, because it's getting on a bit now. I forget, and I think a lot of other people forget that this was actually it was an incredibly exciting show at the time. The concept, the graphics, music, the people, and yes, I'm gonna say it in an age before smartphones, it was like, look at these scantily clad people.
Yes,
it is a part of it.
Mm-hmm.
Whether I don't know who you are, where you are on the scale, but at some point that has made a difference for you.
Yes.
If you're sat there and you're watching it, even if it's in protest, at some point you've gone, well, at least I have this.
Yes. I mean, 11-year-old me was like drooling at, I'd say 11-year-old, I would say, well, how old was I in 89? Oh, God, my maths is terrible. About 8-year-old. Drooling in front of Erica Elmniak. I was like, oh, my God, this is incredible. Wow.
It was such a huge thing. I mean, most people had said, here we go. So I was talking about the whole package, about what makes this great and everything. One of the ones was, like, you know, the opening graphics. It was very shiny. And we had shiny. We had lights. You know, we've seen this before, but it was very slick. And yes, it felt very new and fresh and young. Yeah.
I love the original NBC theme tune, Save Me.
Well, this is it. See, now most people who associate Baywatch with the more famous opening music of the fabulous I'm Always Here. It's right here by Jimmy Jameson.
Yes.
But yes, there was a different tune in season one. Peter Cetera?
Yes, it was indeed. Yes.
I can't remember what it's called. You've told me a dozen times.
It's called Save Me.
Save Me. There, of course it is.
It's on Spotify. If anyone wants to find it, it's a great tune. I would say it's probably slightly better than the one that's everyone's well known, you know, or I'm Always There. It's a good song, but Save Me is quality. It was just that opening theme tune when you first watch it drew you into the show, I thought, when you listen to it. So it's just a shame. I think from what I read that Peter Cetera and David Hasselhoff couldn't come to a agreement on royalties and money and that sort of thing. So they stopped using it.
So, okay. Wow. So I didn't know it was a case of royalties. Now, like, why was it that, I mean, obviously, yes, he's a huge star. He's the Hoff, but yeah. Why is the Hoff getting involved in the opening music?
I mean, I think it because when he brought it back in like series two, I think, like you said, he used a lot of his own money. He helped finance the production company and things like that. So because I know when the initial credits when it initially came out on DVD and that, he couldn't agree to the terms to actually use Save Me on the first season, which was, it was only used for that season. Mm. So they couldn't come to an agreement on royalties for that, but for him selling loads and shitloads of DVDs for it. So that's how that happened. But I think I need to think back to see if I can remember why it wasn't used for when it came back in season two. Originally, I know there was a big thing about royalties, which is why Peter wouldn't allow them to use it for their DVD releases.
So was it a jointly written song or something then, or is it just, it was Peter Cetera? And
I think it's just Peter Cetera's song.
Wow. So, okay. Oh, that's weird. Okay. All right.
So I should have done a deep dive into that, but I'm sure there's somewhere, I'm sure it's around somewhere as to what happened as to why it wasn't used and why they weren't allowed to use it. But, and again, the thing with the DVD release was based on the royalties. They couldn't come up, they couldn't agree on a figure as to how much royalties, because I mean, again, most artists, when they released a song for, I think this is why certain, I think that's why the Wonder Years took forever to get released on DVD, because they were trying to arrange all the royalties with all the music that was used in the show. So,
And it is a bugger trying to agree on on royalties. I remember just changing the subject ever so slightly quick, though, talking to my mum about royalties, funnily enough, and especially I can't think of their name. Spandau Ballet. Crikey. Sorry, everyone. I dozed off for a second then. Talking about Spandau Ballet. There's been issues there with the royalties. So yes, Tony Hadley is the face and the voice of Spandau Ballet. However, he's not chief songwriter. I think that belongs to Gary Kemp, I believe.
Yeah.
And so, there was a bit of an issue with Spandau Ballet songs being performed. And then what's happened is they've gone on the show, all as, you know, as a band, and they've gone, they said, oh, I heard there was some issue with royalties, and Gary's there with a big smile on his face saying, oh, yeah, that's all behind us now. Yeah, we did have some agreements, but it's okay. We've agreed on it. And the rest of the band are just apparently are stony-faced.
Okay.
Like, we haven't agreed on this. We are still really fucking pissed off.
Right.
So, like, people can really hold a grudge, can't they? And things can really just come to a standstill.
Yeah.
When it comes to royalties, which is, again, it's... I don't want to be, just be a grumpy old man. And say, oh, it's just about money. It's just money. Leave it alone. It's just money. But you know, it's it's being paid for your intellectual property, I guess. So
yeah,
we all want a fair crack.
Absolutely.
Be treated fair. But still, man, I mean, it's sad that they even. You know, it's a bit sad that they just. I can't believe they couldn't thrash out a deal for. Being fair, is a show that didn't do particularly well.
Well, I mean, the original series didn't, but the first second season and that it exploded. But I, for some unknown reason, I just remember pretty much all the episodes of season one because, as a kid, I was just drawn into it. I remember me and my friends recreating it in the playgrounds, break times, and things like that. Just pretending we were Baywatch lifeguards. It's like,
I just had this. I wanted to hear that again because I was like, did I just hear that? Am I making things up in my head? It's just not something I think I've ever heard before. But I guess, I guess people, if kids are into something, then they recreate it, don't they? Yeah, I guess so. Kids were really into Baywatch, weren't they? I forgot how much they were.
Were you into it when it came out first time, or was it something you looked at and thought, nah, I'm not looking at that? Or was it something like you watched Knight Rider and the A-Team and Airwolf and you thought, oh, hang on a minute, this is different. There's no big like main car or vehicle in it, but other than the yellow trucks that they used. But is this something that you watched or?
No, you know what? I appreciate that the Hoff was in there, and I really, I didn't go out of my way to avoid it. I would watch it, but I would find myself turning off about halfway through and just go and do something else. I just wasn't a fan, and whilst I don't hate Baywatch. I don't hate it at all. I find myself going, I don't want to watch this, no matter how many times I tried to watch it, especially because my friends were into it. I don't know why it just didn't pop. Something didn't say, oh yeah, you need to watch this. And I think, and that's at the beginning. And I think that stuck with me.
Right.
I think it stuck with me throughout the 90s. And I just went, I've tried. And I went back several times.
Oh.
I went back several times thinking, it's on. Why not give it a go? No one's forcing you to watch it. And I just couldn't wrap my head around it. Then we had the blonde explosion that was Pamela Anderson. Of course, all of a sudden everyone's going absolutely nuts about her. And again, I was also like, great, okay, fantastic, wonderful. Okay. For whatever reason, I couldn't get into this. And again, I think I can't believe I'm going to say this. I'm talking about someone who was like 6 to 16, essentially. But I think even then I want, or not six, or whatever. Mm. Just say for the sake.
Yeah. Eight to 17.
Yeah. Yeah. I just, I think I just wanted something more cerebral.
Right.
I just needed, something to go, this is a mystery that you'll never solve, no matter how many episodes you'll watch. You'll always be there scratching. I just needed something a little bit more. And it just always, I don't know, but that's not the purpose of Baywatch.
No.
The purpose of Baywatch is something, it's just a little bit lighter for a particular part of the day. They were never going to show it at 8:30 to 10:30.
Yeah.
It's not that kind of a program. It is something to get you going. It is a warm-up. It is a light stretch.
Yes, yeah. It was part of the Saturday night light entertainment.
Light stretching television. It's something so you... Right. And it was very much part of the warm-up act, wasn't it, before the main event? You know, around that 3 o'clock to 7 o'clock mark, yes, where he's like, okay, here we go. And like I said, it is a warm-up. It is a light stretch where you don't try and you're not tasking yourself too much mentally. I think it's very much for kids as well rather than adults, or at least like young people rather than older people. So it serves a purpose, you know, and obviously it's not just that, it also kept the Hoff on our screens and relevant. But yeah, I mean, people just needed a little something a little bit silly to get them in the mood, to warm them up so they could get comfy and sit down with dinner and you know, just switch off mentally. Yeah, allow themselves a bit of time to reboot, and that's great. And you know, and also boobs. So you know, it played an important part. It was something that, you know, again, every now and again, we need TV or anything that, you know, that has plays a huge part in our lives needs refreshing. Yeah. Otherwise, we become stagnant and, you know, uninterested and uninspired. Mm-hmm. It's why it's always great when you do get something that's fresh and new that can't be copied easily. Yeah. So, you know, if you know, you say like Stranger Things, it was great and we needed it, but then we immediately had a slew of teen dramas set in the 80s or something. You know what I mean? They were just everywhere, all over Netflix. Yeah. It was just like, oh, please, just end me now. Yeah, but you can't rip off Baywatch.
No.
You're not able to. You can't write something inspired by Baywatch without ripping off Baywatch. Yes. That is something that I will say well done to. They came up with something so unique that I don't know how anyone can rip it off. So you know, it's like I said, I'm not a huge fan, but I recognize its place in society and TV history. But how different was the show, like the first season, to the rest of the season? So you say this is, you know, that's the show, you know, that's the season that sticks with you. Is there a changing writing styles, or is there something that really sets it apart other than the fact that it's the first season?
I mean, I think the first season was, I guess in a way, again, there were some, the episodes I found were like the whole season. There's probably like a couple of episodes in there that they're pretty stupid episodes. But I thought this first season was a little bit more darker than what came afterwards. I mean, you still had the gratuitous like musical interludes where you've got like romantic beach walks and random people walking down with a load of rollerbladers and that to like rock sets. She's got the look, which actually happened in one episode. I don't know. I just thought the characters were more interesting in the first season. Obviously, they changed the actor for Hobie in the second season to Jeremy Jackson, and I don't know. Something about him as an actor just really annoyed me. they had the Aussie guy in there as well, Peter Phelps. He was quite an arrogant character, but quite a good character as well. They had Jill in there as well, Sean Weatherly, who gets eaten by a shark. Well, doesn't get eaten by a shark, but gets attacked by a shark. She dies. I just thought like, from the second series onwards, and then when Pamela and all the other, because I know when Eddie and Shawnee leave, they just get more and more like female lifeguards in there, and
I wonder why.
Yes, I think from like season 3 to 4 onwards, they just, some of the storylines are just like ridiculous. Whereas I just thought the first season was a lot more closer to home and like well, say close to the home, not like I know what happens on the beach or in California, but it seemed to me like these storylines seemed a lot more plausible that would happen in the US than some of the stuff that came on afterwards. I bought.
Yeah, they actually bothered to write in the first series, and then I imagine there's a script writer somewhere screaming, screaming in at the sky at some of the storylines, from season two onwards, or especially season three or four onwards. And that happens a lot, sadly, doesn't it?
It does, yeah. And I'm trying to think. So it was on NBC originally, and NBC's pretty. It can be a pretty serious place. There's some dramas on there. I mean, I know they do comedy as well, but I'm trying to think of like who took up. I don't know who. I'm trying to think of who they actually went to in the second series is like what right. who I think it. I think they did it themselves. So I think that's maybe why they thought, we're doing it with our own money. So it was, I guess they trying to tweak it to make it more internationally agreeable, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Rather than the first one where I think they maybe tried to maybe just point it and aim it at only at Americans and things like that. I know they had an Aussie in there as well, but... I think they tried to, make it a little bit more international friendly and the storyline's a bit more, not as plausible, but some of them were plausible. But I mean, some of them were just ridiculously absurd, which, some European countries find quite amusing. So,
I mean, that's why it was parodied so much. The trouble is people kept going back and they kept watching. So what do you try and go back to how it was in season one so people stop taking the piss out of you, but lose, potentially lose viewers? Or do you just carry on doing whatever you're doing and, you can take the piss out of us as much as you like, but we are the best watched show in the world. And a lot of that was not down, let's face it, none of that was down to the storylines.
No.
None of that was down to the storylines. It was literally, I think, but it's for the shits and giggles and the flesh that was on the show. At a time where, I don't know how the two things line up on a timeline, but was it the invention of broadband, no matter how slow it wasn't dial-up. So where does broadband, the invention of broadband and the installation of broadband, I should say, into people's homes, and the decline of viewers numbers in Baywatch, how does that line up? Because if I'm being crude and a little bit unfair to the show, I wouldn't be surprised if they lined up all of a sudden, broadband is being installed en masse in homes around the world, and all of a sudden, the numbers for Baywatch start dwindling.
Yeah.
It would not surprise me. And again, it's probably not very fair. It's probably a bit crude, but, I mean, come on. Like, there has to be, and I know I'm just saying it, it's boobs, 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 from season three or four onwards.
Yeah.
But that's what they allowed it to be. They had a show in season one.
Yes.
And they went, right, no one's interested. No one's interested in a cerebral.
Well, I was interested.
Yeah.
I loved that first season.
Well, this is it. Lots of people, there are lots of people that like cerebral, well-written TV shows. And if you know what, if the setting's a little bit out there, great, let it be out there. Sometimes I don't want to see another police procedural show. No. Sometimes I want to see a well-written show about something a bit different. But if it's not an absolute hit with people of limited I could alienate a large portion of the world now, actually I don't care.
Okay,
but instead of making a good show for intelligent people, the way to be famous is to make a stupid show of limited intelligence for people of limited intelligence and taste.
Yeah.
So, and those are the shows. Those are the shows that generally, or, you know, the songs or whatever, that do quite well. And, you know, point, you know, oh, man, I'm tired. My brain is my brain is going. X Factor.
Yeah,
that's a really great example. Big Brother. Mm-hmm. It requires no talent to write that.
Yeah,
it requires and it just requires a house with cameras.
Yeah,
and then say, idiots, assemble. And people with corrosive personalities who are a bit fame hungry can just they just do whatever they want, and all of a sudden it's got millions of people watching it. So again, it's quite sad. I wish that the first series, the one that you fell in love with, the one that made you think, you know what, I never want this to end. I want to watch this every single week. I wish we had that show.
Yeah, because I mean, I remember when it came back, I was like, wow, Baywatch is coming back, amazing. And I remember being disappointed because, you know, most of the cast, the cast was half of what it was originally. I mean, they still had David Hasselhoff, they still had Shorty and Eddie. And they had the guy who was actually a real lifeguard, but they had him in the show anyway. He went through like the whole series, I think, or the whole seasons.
That guy with a mustache?
Yes. Yes. But I mean, they got rid of Parker Stevenson, who I thought was a good character. The Aussie guy, Peter Phelps, wasn't in it. And I just thought, you know, I was disappointed that the music had changed, the theme tune. I was like, oh, is this the same Baywatch? I don't think it is. And I'm just, you know, the second series was okay to me because it still had like the characters, a couple of the characters that I really enjoyed in the first one. But and then it just, from season three onwards, when Pamela, I mean, I wasn't a big fan of Pamela Anderson. I didn't think she could act. I think the only reason she was there was, well, two reasons, really. Why she was there. I think Yasmin Bleeth was brought in and she was okay. But I mean, I don't know. It just, it lost a lot of its magic from the first season. I don't know what happened. I don't know if there's any, like, actual Baywatch fans out there who I just think they made it. The first season was more drama. I mean, if you can watch the first season on an app called Freeview or Free VEE or whatever it's called.
Oh, Freevee.
Yeah, Freevee.
Oh, yeah, I love Freevee.
And if you watch the first season, you'll know that there's elements of comedy in the show, comedy romance, but it's more, a lot more dramatic than the season twos onwards. Season two, they were tried to do like a lot of, you know, they did drama, but they tried to make it a lot more comedic as well. And I was just like, you know, it should just be drama with a little elements of comedy in there, a little sprinkling here and there, not just try to make it ridiculously, you know, fantasy. You know, you're living in the real world, you know, you've got, you know, rescues to make, but, you know, I think they just had too many characters to, you know, have a storyline on. Concentrate. Whereas the original series, they had like four or five characters where they were trying, you know, do a storyline on them per episode or something like that. But I think on the other, when it went from season two onwards, or when Shawnee and Eddie left in season three, it then went, we've got like seven or eight characters we've got to focus their characters on. And they tried to shove a lot of more storyline into one episode, you know, each episode. It was just like,
doesn't always work, does it? It's got to be done cleverly and carefully. And you can't just, you can't just shove too much in there all in one go. Otherwise, people are just going to fart all over it.
Absolutely, yeah. It's
I mean, like, so season two, not bad, you know. You obviously season one's your best. Season two, you don't mind. Season three, it got a bit mental. But you know, so within, are there any of your, and obviously you're gonna, a load of your favorite episodes are gonna be in season one. So discounting season one, just ignore that for a minute. Do you have any favorite episodes from any of the other seasons that you think, actually, here we go. Yes, it's taken a detour from what I loved about it originally, but here we go. It's still got it. This is why it's still around.
I mean, I remember the episode where they had Hulk Hogan and Randy Savage in it. I'm not saying it was a good episode. They had Hogan, Savage, Flair, Vader. It was like a WCW episode where they had them fight each other in a beach match or something like that. I was just that was really weird. I mean, season two isn't bad. I'm just trying to think of episodes that they did. I mean, they had episodes in season two where I think Eddie gets accused of rape, and they spend two episodes trying to disprove it and make, you know, get him off, which they do end up getting him off at the time. So,
so it's good that they didn't rush that. I mean, again, two episodes, it probably does feel rushed, but at least,
yeah,
at least with a show that could be anywhere from half an hour to 40 minutes long, they spent two episodes doing it. That's not something that I would expect from Baywatch, to be fair.
No, they did. There was quite a lot of, they did quite a few one and two parts.
Yeah, but for such a big, and obviously controversial subject.
Yeah, that's very true. I mean, they have, I think there's an episode with Shannon Tweed in it. I don't know if you remember Shannon Tweed from the 90s.
Yeah, name rings a bell.
I think she's still married to Gene Simmons from Kiss, but she was like a big, erotic film star.
Oh, yes. I know who you mean now, yeah.
Yeah, they had her and Mitch sort of have this sort of love affair, but she finds out that she's actually a murderess or something. And that storyline, which is, again, it's strange but interesting. I mean, I'm trying to think. They were dealing with toxic waste as well, which, you know, again, there's always a problem on a beach and getting it shown into, shoved into the actual ocean, toxic waste. Sharks were always a big part of the show as well. They always did episodes with sharks around. It's difficult. I mean, I always lean towards my favorite episodes in season one. I mean, there's so many. I ended up watching, running through them again all week, this week, last week even, and just the amount of episodes that I just remember, how great the episode was. So I would say that season one is my favorite.
It's worth people going back and watching that season alone.
Absolutely, yeah. It's just a much better, well-made series, I thought, than the other episode, the other seasons. So,
okay, yeah. So earlier on, you touched on are there any other fans who maybe they might know what you were trying to say?
Yeah,
something that I stumbled upon. Ooh. Another time, because I was actually following OSW, which is an old school wrestling show, and they're three Irish guys, absolutely hilarious. They're huge, they're absolutely massive. It's wrestling. I'm not anymore, but it is funny. It is so, they are pant-wettingly funny. They're brilliant.
Yeah,
I love the OSW boys, and they actually feature on another YouTube show called Baywatching.
Oh, okay.
Now, like I said, I stumbled across it because I had I'd been watching a few OSW episodes, and here we are, they're on Baywatching. So basically, they go through and they review.
Yeah.
Old Baywatch episodes, and they say what they liked about it, what they didn't like about it. And the reason why they got the OSW boys on there is because Shawn Michaels stars in an episode called Look Who's Coming to Dinner.
Yeah, I actually watched that episode the other day. I forgot he was in it, but yeah, I remember that.
He plays a thug, for a gangster. Now this is a very troubling episode. Okay, it's written, directed, and acted incredibly badly. And is somehow not on anyone's top 10 worst episodes ever. And I looked at a lot of those top 10 or just the worst Baywatch episodes ever. I did this extensively. Ooh. One website has about 30 of the worst Baywatch episodes ever. Someone's obviously has a lot of time and a lot of hatred for Baywatch. But this is an absolute shit show of an episode, which features Pamela Anderson's character CJ. Yeah. Is CJ, isn't it? I'm just made that because I've been watching a lot of The West Wing, and there's a character on there called CJ. I'm like, my tired brain making that up. Singer-actress Connie Stevens comes in as CJ's mum, and it's god awful. It's a terrible, terrible episode. It also doesn't paint Shawn Michaels in a particularly good light, which I think is why he leaves out of both of his autobiographies. Yeah. But this got a 6 out of 10 on IMDb, which kind of leaves me shuddering.
Really?
At what happened on the episodes that were rated 5 or less.
Ooh.
Like, if there are Baywatch episodes, I mean, let's face it, 6 is an average.
Yeah.
Right? So if that's supposed to be an average episode, what, there must be like, I shudder to think, like, what's on, let's say if there's an episode and you see it's rated 3 out of 10 on IMDb, you'd be like, do you watch that? Because that's half an hour to 40 minutes of your life you might never get back again.
Yeah.
You know, that were wasted. That, well, I don't know about anyone else. I'm a very dramatic person, and I'd feel like that would actually hurt me mentally and physically to watch one of these episodes that were like 3 out of 10. It's crazy. I mean, so yeah, some of them, it just goes to show how bad they were, but yet how much of a part of the fabric of our society it actually was, that they could keep churning out this shit. People just go, it's Baywatch. It's Baywatch. Mm-hmm. But it's Baywatch. Much like Jerry Springer. It was absolute horse shit. It was brain rot. It should come with a warning label that this is bad for your intelligence and your mind. Watching this will make you stupid. Warning across the front of it. Guessing you're going somewhere in a similar direction that I'm going in. What, you see, that was the 90s.
Yeah, the 90s were a different time.
yeah, that's it. It was a different time. We were allowed. Yeah. But it's never changed.
Yeah,
it's never changed. We still keep putting absolute garbage on our screens for our young people to watch, and they lap it up. Much like we did back at the time. We're like, oh, this is rubbish. Very nice, very nice. Keep watching it. It's like, oh my word, what is wrong with us? But then you go back and you close your eyes and you concentrate, and you can, I mean, just for me, because I can't remember the Peter Cetera song, which is terrible. I know, but I can remember that keyboard, that piano opening.
And then when I hear
dun, 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 and I see that the graphics fly across the screen, bright colors and everything, and David Hasselhoff on a speedboat in a crisp white iron shirt. It's like, and they're carrying red things around with them. Brilliant. Okay. It is ridiculously easy to fall into this trap and to be, you know, and not be able to put it down again, not be able to just leave it. Because also, if we forget that other people watch this and other people are interested, and we want to be part of that discussion. I mean, I didn't, but I'm very different, apparently. I'm an alien. But
you're not in New York.
No. And I just think, well, yeah, I do forget sometimes that I'm a visitor to this planet, and or how at least it feels that way sometimes.
Yeah.
But everyone else wanted to be in that conversation. Did you see Baywatch? Yeah. We want to be in those water cooler moments, even when we're kids. I don't know what you would call it. Would it still be a water cooler moment? You don't have water coolers at school.
No.
But you know, that sit down at the desk moment. It's like, did you watch Baywatch last night? Yes. Oh my God, wasn't that good? Because again, 89 to say 96, no one's got phones.
No.
They're not texting each other. Certainly don't have smartphones or FaceTime or whatever, or WhatsApp, and just go, holy shit, what was that episode about? Oh my God. So even if you didn't see your friends on the Sunday, then it was a huge talking point on Monday. So like you've alluded to, you were recreating the episodes.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, you loved it. So yeah, you are very much part of that. You're very much part of that crowd. You know, everyone else, it's like you don't understand the buzz that was around it. And I feel a little bit cheated.
Oh.
I feel a little bit cheated that I didn't get so excited about it. There were elements to it. Like I said, the opening of the show, the fact that it was in California, the Hoth, and you know, these bright red costumes, and it's like, it's wow, that really is, that's phenomenal. That's an eye opener.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you couldn't do this down Boscombe Beach, could you? There, you know, everyone would have to be wearing. Trainers, because it's a stony beach and they'd be like falling all over the place and, you know, tripping over driftwood or whatever. There's Mildred sat in her beach hut at the back. It was such an eye-opener. It was such a brand new, shiny, beautiful, wonderful thing. So as much as I turn around and give it shit, I can totally see why people like yourself got in there early, stuck around no matter how bad it got.
I mean, to be fair, you say I stuck around, but I didn't, to be honest. I think after, oh man, I want to say maybe five seasons, maybe six, I just stopped watching it, because I think obviously I was getting older, and the storylines and the different cast changes and all that just kind of like, I was like, yeah, as much as I love the Hoth, I'm just like, I can't watch this anymore. I do remember. I know I didn't watch from like season seven onwards. I've never seen any of the Baywatch Hawaii. Well, I have seen some of them because it came on Amazon a few years ago, and I was watching a couple of episodes of that, which wasn't too bad. But yeah, I did kind of give up on it. But again, I'll always watch the first season. I got season one on DVD years ago. I watched it again recently. Again, I'll stick by season. I'll fight anyone who says season one isn't a good one. There's so many great, so many great episodes on season one. I would even suggest that you watch. You know, if you didn't see season one, go back and watch it, and just, you know, maybe watch a few random episodes in other seasons, and then you'll be like, I see what Danger's talking about here. Season one was far, far superior to the other seasons that came.
I tell you what, I will. I've only ever seen from season two onwards.
Oh, okay.
Okay, I have seen, like, I've watched it properly.
Yeah.
I say properly, not properly at all. But I've at the time, I
you have seen it. Yeah.
I've seen clips of season one, but I cannot. Really justify turn around saying, oh yeah, I've seen season one. There's no way I can defend myself because I've just seen clips. So I think, yeah, it does require watching. It does, you know, I think after, once I'm done with the West Wing,
yeah,
I'm so into that at the moment. I never watched it the first time round.
No, I didn't either, to be honest. I'd only watched season one to two recently, so I need to pick up from season three onwards.
Yeah, so I'm halfway through season three. Bloody love it. So I need, yeah, I think once I'm done with that, I will definitely go back and watch season one, because I wasn't aware that it was so different.
I think it is so different too. I mean, season two isn't too bad, but I mean, again, they just got rid of quite a few. The cast members were dwindled down. So, like, you know, it's not bad, but it's not as good as the first season. I think the first season is the best season they've ever done. And it wasn't as popular. Like you said, it was cancelled. They were just like, yep, we're cancelling that. But it must have been popular, because in syndication in the States, it was, you know, repeated. So, you know, obviously, I know, like, Michael Burke and Douglas Schwartz and the Hoff, they worked closely together. So they put their own money in and produced the show themselves. So, and plus it was, I think the first season was pretty popular in the UK as well. So I think, again, this is how they managed to bring it back a year later. So.
Oh, I imagine it was. I can't imagine at any point, whether it's a good or shit program, I can't imagine there's anything that's as glitzy and as glamorous and new and exciting as Baywatch was, and it not be fucking massive over here in the late 80s, early 90s. We were eating that shit up. Like, it felt very, it felt old over here, 89, 90. It felt old.
And this was brand new and shiny and
They looked like sunny. They looked like they were already in the mid 90s in 89. Yes. Where at times we felt like we were still in the early 80s in 89, 90.
Yeah.
We have learned. I think we've gone a bit nuts, and then we've gone, okay, let's find our style over here. And it is essentially we've stopped trying to copy. Copy everyone else. Now we've gone through patches, we've gone through stages of copying other countries and how they do stuff. I think we've kind of like, I don't feel like the world is old now, you know. I feel like it's I feel like we've learned our lessons, you know. We stay current and we stay fresh. So with that in mind, is there any way that this could come back? I mean, it wouldn't be fresh and exciting. I mean, like, we had the Hawaii.
You had the movie as well, which was more.
But neither of those have done particularly well, have they?
No.
Baywatch at Night, or what was it called?
Baywatch Night. So what? When the Hoff decided he wanted to be a private detective and work at night, which again was on. I mean. It was a pretty popular show in the mid 90s. It had him and the guy who was the motorcycle cop on there as well, Garner.
Oh, right, yeah, he was actually the actual detective, wasn't he? And like,
yeah, he was.
Mitch was there to like help out or something.
Yes, Baywatch Nights. Yeah,
and they were like battling like werewolves and vampires and shit. I'm like,
did have some weird. Yeah, it wasn't great.
What the fuck is this about? Like, that was a perfect chance. That was a perfect chance for them to do something a little bit grittier and to be taken seriously away from the show, using the show as a platform to do something amazing, but then be doing something so you're taken more seriously. Saying, okay, yeah, we're still going to do Baywatch, and yes, it is silly, but people love it.
Yes.
But I'm going to do Baywatch Nights as well. You know, it could have been something a little bit more, I don't mean adult as in, you know, X-rated. I just mean something a little bit directed a bit more at adults instead. But instead, he took Baywatch and he put his hand on the ridiculous dial and went, oh, turn up to 12. Yes. Which seems kind of crazy to me. Like, he's not, I think we've got to remember that celebrities are not faultless.
No,
they're not faultless geniuses, all of them. Yeah, it's people are going to make mistakes, but I think that's a huge, I'd say potentially as or more of a bad decision as veering away from the kind of content that you'd get in season one and going to how it was from season four onwards.
Yeah, you know, I mean,
season three onwards or whatever. I mean, do you not think that hurt Baywatch?
By having the spin-off?
A terrible one.
Wow. I mean, I guess it did because, I mean, it was, you know, it was done in 95. I mean, the idea was pretty interesting. But I think, like, the first series, I think, wasn't too bad, I think. But then the ratings fell into season two. So I don't think that did it any good. But, yeah, it's possible. I don't think it did it. I don't think it did the actual show a lot of favors itself. But I mean, I don't know how many Baywatch fans actually watch Baywatch Nights, to be honest. So, I'm trying to think. I think they aired it in the UK, but I think it was like they tried to class it as a, like you say, as a more adulty show. So it was like done at night rather than in the early afternoon. So, you know, normally in 20 minutes time, back in the 90s, we'd be like, right, let's wrap this up because we got to watch Baywatch because that's coming on at 5:30. So I think like Baywatch Nights was on at 10 or 10:30. So,
wow. See, that's crazy because if they put it on that late and they've tried to you know, direct it towards an older crowd, then they didn't do a particularly good job of it.
No.
Which is a bit sad. Okay, right. Well, let's finish on a positive note.
Yeah.
Your three favorite characters.
Three favorite characters.
Yeah, and they can't all be from season one.
Oh man.
So you've got to take someone from season. Okay, from we'll say from season three onwards.
Oh.
You can. Okay. You've got to take one character from season who turned up season three or four onwards.
Oh,
and you can, but the other two can be from season one, if you like.
Okay, so,
and if, by the way, everyone, if Dange doesn't mention your favorite character, we don't care. It's okay. I'm just literally just putting him under pressure, having given him absolutely no notice of doing this. Don't worry, he doesn't hate your favorite character. It's okay. You can send us a nice email saying, Dange didn't pick so and so. That's a shame because I really like this. You can send that email and no complaints to TIDRP inbox. That is all one word. TIDRP inbox at gmail.com. Send us all your comments and your ideas and your likes and your dislikes and say, but not your complaints. No, you can send us anything you like. I've got nothing to do. I'll give you something to read. Send whatever you like and let us know how you feel about Baywatch and how you feel about this episode. And of course, go. Make sure you go and watch Baywatching as well.
Yeah, Baywatching.
It's not bad. Not too shabby at all. And it's a nice little time waster. You'll be happier afterwards, I should hope. So go on then. Your three favourite characters.
I wouldn't say... I guess she was probably better of a bad bunch, but I would say maybe... Yasmin Bleeth as Caroline Holden.
Okay, why is that then?
I don't know. she was okay. I mean, she had some good storylines. She was nice to look at. I wasn't a massive fan of any of the characters. I mean, David Charvet as Matt Brody, his character was okay, but I mean, he was a bit of a wet fish at times. I remember one episode where he was like on a, you know, he had like a bad boy thing where he's on a bike and he was trying to be like a Hollywood star and his dad didn't want him to be a lifeguard and he was driving his bike and he had his bike stolen or something and he had to get it back. I was like, oh God, this is ridiculous. So, I mean, I just chose her as, you know, bad bunch.
Okay. All right, the best of a bad bunch. Okay, right. So how about your other two? Who's going to be the king and queen, not necessarily king and queen, but you know, who are your two favorite characters from season one that you couldn't live without?
To be honest, there's quite a few of them. I liked all of them, to be honest, from that season. Craig Pomeroy was a good character. Parker Stevenson, who was a lawyer and wanted to be a lifeguard as well at the same time.
A lawyer guard.
Yes, I'm gonna probably say, just purely because iconic, I'm gonna say probably Eddie and Shawnee were my two favorite characters from season one. Eddie was the street. You know, he had been adopted and he lived on. You know, he ran away from adopted people, parents, and you know, he was a tough guy, liked to box. He was just a good character, I thought, and Shawnee, for other reasons, that you know, he fancied her at the time. So I always thought she was much, much more superior than Pamela Anderson, but that's just my opinion. So
well, there you go.
I mean, the Hoff is always a well-known character. You know, he's in every episode, pretty much every episode that they film. So, you know, I couldn't pick him because that would have just been too easy, really. I mean,
he don't need your charity.
No. Yeah. So, yeah, I would say those are the three characters.
Well, there you go. There we go. You've heard it here, folks. I think that's all the time we have for Baywatch.
I could talk for another hour about the episodes of season one, but
I'll
go away and watch it after you've finished watching The West Wing.
I know. I was thinking, like, oh, do I get Danger to talk about like his favorite episodes? And I thought, no, because he's going to tell me minute for minute, like, or second for second, what happens in each episode. Like, you'll do almost like you've got the script in front of you and you'll just be there reading the whole thing as it happened. So I thought, well, okay, we won't do that. And it just means that people go out there with, and be surprised by how awesome or how terrible is, you know, you can never, you know, there's no accounting for taste.
No,
so there you go.
That'll be my next career. Dane reads Baywatch on audio.
You start each episode with a little bit of a spoken word song. I like big butts, and I cannot lie.
And no, then spoken word the theme tune.
Of course, yes, of course, yes. So that's how you open each episode.
I'll be ready. Forever and all ever, I'll be there. Some people stand in the darkness.
Okay, so there you go. That's going to be Dangerous's next. That could run alongside doing this show.
Yeah, Dangerous podcast, Dangerous Baywatch, Dange Baywatch, or something stupid.
Dange Watch.
Shall we move on to Ask Dangerous?
Absolutely. Gazzy needs some coffee. I'll tell you what, whilst I'm grabbing some coffee, why don't you go off and get yourself a cup of tea, get a bicky and get yourself comfy, and we will see you in a few.
Here we go.
Ask Dangerous Day. Ask Dangerous Day. Stuff about the old days. Gas has got the questions, Dave's got the memories, maybe that is pop culture trivia, yeah.
Oh, hi there. I didn't hear you knock. Come on in and warm yourself up by the fireplace. Pour yourself a drink and settle back and listen to another delightful Ask Dangerous show. Gotta get up. 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 And time won't take my love away. You're such a hot temptation. You just walk right in. Walk right in. Gotta get up. Walk right in. Cause you're right on time. Let me tell you. What you do. You're such a hot temptation. You just walk right in. Walk right in. I'm not going to do any more of that. Because that just goes on forever. So yes, you're right on time for the continuation of the greatest 80s and 90s UK hits countdown, where we pit the 80s versus the 90s UK number ones. So let's hand it over to Dr. Frank and Gaz to find out what he has in store for us this week, shall we?
I thought you were having a breakdown for a minute. Oh dear.
I think I did have a breakdown.
We're recording the breakdown of a man. Oh dear. Right. Yes, I am Gaz. Now,
you are.
Yes, now with 30% extra zzz than all other Gazes.
Yes.
Each week we delve into the mind of Dangerous to determine the greatest 80s and 90s UK chart number one ever. This week, I'll give Dangerous six matchups, and he has to choose who is the superior tune, and therefore will progress to the next round. Some big hitters have gone home already, and it's only going to get more controversial and more upsetting for me. But this is Ask Dangerous. He is mighty, and his word, final. Sir Dangerous, are you ready to ride bravely into battle upon your mighty steed?
I am ready, my fellow knight.
Okay. Good. Oh, jolly good. Matchup one.
Oh, hi there. I didn't hear you knock. Come on in and warm yourself up by the fireplace. Pour yourself a drink and settle back and listen to another delightful Ask Dangerous show. Gotta get up. And time won't take my love away. You're such a hot temptation. You just walk right in. Walk right in. Gotta get up. Walk right in. Cause you're right on time. Let me tell you. What you do. You're such a hot temptation. You just walk right in. Walk right in. I'm not going to do any more of that. Because that just goes on forever. So yes, you're right on time for the continuation of the greatest 80s and 90s UK hits countdown, where we pit the 80s versus the 90s UK number ones. So let's hand it over to Dr. Frank and Gaz to find out what he has in store for us this week, shall we?
I thought you were having a breakdown for a minute. Oh dear. We're recording the breakdown of a man. Oh dear. Right. Yes, I am Gaz.
Now, you are.
Yes, now with 30% extra zzz than all other Gazes.
Yes.
Each week we delve into the mind of Dangerous to determine the greatest 80s and 90s UK chart number one ever. This week, I'll give Dangerous six matchups, and he has to choose who is the superior tune, and therefore will progress to the next round. Some big hitters have gone home already, and it's only going to get more controversial and more upsetting for me. But this is Ask Dangerous. He is mighty, and his word, final. Sir Dangerous, are you ready to ride bravely into battle upon your mighty steed?
I am ready, my fellow knight.
Okay. Good. Oh, jolly good. Matchup one. Something's Gotten a Hold of My Heart by Mark Almond.
Oh.
Versus Melanie B featuring Missy Elliott, I Want You Back.
Oh, God. Mel B and Missy Elliott versus Mark Almond.
Something's Gotten a Hold of My Heart was originally by Gene Pitney. Like, I was thinking, oh, I don't really know this song. And the second you put it on, you're like, ah, yes. Yeah. I know this, but it's not. I'm surprised it hit number one, if I'm honest. But then I can't lie. Mel B featuring Missy Elliott, I Want You Back, I actually bought that single.
Oh, really?
I helped contribute to that.
So it's your fault.
Yes, my fault. Yeah, I did. There was just one song in it. but if I remember thinking that was, so cool. That was such a badass song. Just a little bit different from what we'd come to know her for. And you know, no one could convince me any differently. And then I went back to it about 10 years later and I was like, what is this shit? So I don't think neither of them have aged well, I would say.
I mean, I can't quite remember the Mel B song, to be honest. I know she did it, and I know Missy Elliott was on it, and it was obviously that memorable, because I'm just like, I can't quite... I mean, I know Something's Got a Hold of Your Heart by Mark Almond. It's not the best song in the world. I think I'm going to make a decision purely based out of spite, and I'm going to put through Mark Almond and Something's Got a Hold of Your Heart.
Based on spite. Well, because you absolutely...
Fuck Mel B.
What's this? Why is there so much anger directed towards Mel B?
Oh, I was not a Spice Girls fan, so that's...
Right, okay. Right. Matchup two. Let It Be by Fairy Aid.
Ooh.
Versus Nothing's Gonna Change My Love for You by Glenn Medeiros.
Oh, wow.
I promise, I didn't realise that Glenn Medeiros had anything to do with Baywatch until, because I did this, clicked on it, as just closed my eyes.
Yeah.
Press it. There we go. Cut and paste. Bosh.
Yeah.
And I didn't know that he had anything to do with Baywatch until after I... then went back and started looking into it a bit more. I couldn't bloody believe it.
Yeah.
But, obviously, you know Let It Be by Fairy Aid. It's a cover of... John Lennon.
Let It Be. Yes. Yeah.
Nothing's Going to Change My Love for You. Honestly, this sounds... Glenn Medeiros here, he sounds like a combination of Peter Cetera, Michael Bolton, and Asia.
He does.
That's the band, not the continent, by the way. if you combine those three, like those two performers in that band, then all of a sudden you get, in this instance, you get Glenn Medeiros and Nothing's Going to Change My Love for You. It's actually not a bad song.
I thought this was one of my favourite songs of the 80s, so... I really enjoyed this song. I mean, I think it's a cover, isn't it? So, man, I think I'm going to have to put through Glenn Medeiros and Nothing's Going to Change My Love for You. It's a song originally by one of my favorite artists ever, George Benson. So, yes.
Oh, okay. There you go. Right. There you go. Cover versus cover then. Didn't know that. Okay. Matchup three. Live and Joy with Dreamer.
Oh.
Versus Seasons in the Sun by Waste of Life. Sorry, I mean Westlife.
Oh. That's Dreamer song's pretty good, actually.
Dream on, Dreamer. That was a good song. I really did. That's a song that doesn't get remembered, sadly.
Yeah.
One of those ones that people would go like, oh, I've never heard that on a best of. Yeah, like a now that's what I call 90s or whatever.
Yeah.
Was it, or was it late 80s? No, it was early 90s, wasn't it?
I believe it was, yeah.
But yeah, because it doesn't end up
because it doesn't end up on like a now that's what I call 90s or whatever, there's loads of people who have forgotten it or will never know of it, you know, younger people. So that's kind of sad. But and yet, Seasons in the Sun by Westlife, covering a they did a lot of covers. They hit it big with a not a song of their own, because they didn't bloody write it. And then they did like three or four covers.
They did.
So it's a bit naughty. Now, this was originally, this was been covered a couple of times, but originally it was by the Beach Boys.
Yeah. Well, I mean, again, I wasn't a big Westlife fan. Which is the better song? I mean, it is a good song.
Yeah, it's all right. It's not bad.
I think, again, out of spite, I'm going to put through Dreamer, because I'll be asked to put Westlife through.
Fuck off, Westlife. Yes, oh, there you go. Season in the Sun goes home. The set has sun. No, the sun is set on Seasons in the Sun. Bloody hell. Okay, so what happens when you're poisoning yourself? All right. Match up four. It is My Birthday Song. It is Red Red Wine, another cover version. Red Red Wine by UB40.
Oh.
Versus Take That with Shaw.
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 Wow. I mean, that's a, for some reason, that's a song I don't remember them singing.
Exactly my thinking. I don't think it was about men's deodorant.
No. Oh, man.
I do not remember. I mean, it could have been, it could have been like the song that you consider to be their best song ever, perhaps. And then it would have a chance of standing up to Red Red Wine.
Yeah.
But I don't remember that. And you know what? Honestly, we say Take That actually didn't, you know, we congratulate them on actually not doing bad songs quite a lot.
Yeah.
And I think in this instance, I just went, oh, I've given them too much of my time. Fuck off. So I didn't bother to, I decided to save myself 30 seconds.
Okay. Well, that's fair enough.
Yeah.
Oh. Well, I think.
I mean, I've already put the tick next to it.
Yeah. I mean, if it had been like a million love songs or something like that, I probably would have gone for that. But I think, I mean, Red Red Wine is a good song by UB40. It's a pretty good cover version. I'm going to put through Red Red Wine.
Okay. Matchup five.
Yes.
Oasis.
Oh.
Don't Look Back in Anger.
Yeah, I heard you say.
Yeah. Versus Pastor Dutchie by Musical Youth.
Oh, wow.
Now, I know what I would put through, but this isn't Ask As. This is Ask Dangerous.
Don't Look Back in Anger. I mean, that's a good song, to be honest. Good song.
The music is a bit of a rip-off of John Lennon, but I can forgive them that for some absolutely cracking lyrics.
Yeah. Pastor Dutchie isn't a bad song, but, I mean, lyrically, there isn't that much lyrics in there. Is there? So,
it's not poetry, no. Nah. I mean, I think it's certainly fun, and some thought has gone into it. But, yeah, it's not, you know, it's not poetry. It's not Keats. No. Yeah, you know, like, you're like, oh, wow, that stirs me. That stirs something inside of me. Yeah, it's just fun.
Yeah, and I mean, again, even though they're Manx and they wind me up a lot these days, and I know they don't talk to each other and that, but they did some great tunes in the 90s. So I think based off of that, I'm going to have to put through Don't Look Back in Anger.
Okay, right. I mean, I already had that, but yep, sure. I already knew that's what you were going to say.
Okay. Was that what you would have put through, or was it going to be Pastor Dutchie on the
No, No, as much as I don't think Oasis are amazing.
Yeah. Well, we've had that debate already.
Exactly. Don't Look Back in Anger had to go through. It is a smashing song. Right, yeah. Match six. This could be a little bit more. This could be a little bit more of a difficult decision for you.
Ooh.
The Lady in Red by Chris de Burgh.
Oh, what a tune!
Versus the Fugees, Ready or Not.
Oh, here I come. Can I find you?
And oh, make man. You watch me.
Two good songs.
Indeed.
Ah, Chris de Burgh, Lady in Red. What a song that is.
Is dancing with me.
Cheek to cheek.
Although I tell you what I don't like is that the fact that he has a certain way of speaking, obviously. So how do you say romance? Romance. For the sake of the song, so it rhymes with dance.
Romance and dance. Yeah.
Do you want to say dance and romance? Nope, it's dance and romance. Ah. All right then. We're going with it. Chris wants to go with it, really. There's no such word as romance, though. I know, but he's going with it. He refuses to say dance. If you wanted to dance, he's like, he could have done that. You know, yes. If you wanted to dance. All right, Chris. And the food. Yeah, so it's a tricky one. I've got absolutely nothing bad to say about the Fugees, but it's still not easy, is it? It's still not an easy decision to make.
No. Lady in Red. Classic 80s. Ready or Not. Classic 90s, to be honest.
Lots of dead empty space.
No, I know. <I'm>
quite... It's just all of a sudden I just realised. Oh, no one's saying anything on. no one's saying anything on a medium where you really need to keep talking. Okay, fill the space. Fill the space.
Lady in Red.
It's really stumped you, this one, isn't it?
Yeah, they're both good songs.
Yeah. There we go, people. So if you're finding this a bit easier than Dange, send it in. Let us know who goes home, Chris de Burgh or the Fugees. Let us know. TIDRP inbox, all one word. TIDRP inbox, all one word, @gmail.com. Come on, what have you got? What have you got, big boy?
I am going to put through the Fugees.
Oh,
Ready or Not.
Wow. Crikey O'Reilly. Okay. Bye-bye, Christopher. He's going to go traveling.
He is. Yes.
That particular spaceman will go traveling. Toodaloo. To back home to your Lady in Red.
Yes, absolutely. That was good. I enjoyed those songs. Looking forward to next week's one. So I think it's time to exit now. Back again.
Hi there, Pod fans. Thanks for joining us as we take another glance into the past and have a retrospective gander at what we were all talking about back in the day. So we can do this, I send Dangerous out to the garage and I have him wheel in our favourite item of record-rousing detail-detecting bit of kit. Here it is in all its glory, the Retro Monthinator 3000. Right, I don't know about you, but I'm hungry for some headlines. Dange, fire up that pooter.
Hello,
Good evening. Here are your headlines for November 1989. First showing of the clay animation film A Grand Day Out, introducing Wallace and Gromit, is in a film festival in Bristol. All Around the World is UK number one, and Back to the Future Part Two hits the UK cinemas.
Ooh, Back to the Future.
Part two, yes.
Part two. Oh, yes. All right. Right. Yes. Part two. Of course.
Part two.
A Grand Day Out. Crikey, was it that long ago?
Yes. Wallace and Gromit.
Oh, bloody hell. The concept of... I remember, like... Okay, so we are all aware of animation. Yes. Yeah, we've seen Morph.
Yes.
we get
clay
it.
Clay animation, yeah.
We understand this. But it did seem... But at the same time, it still seemed so fresh and new and exciting.
Yeah.
And I just, it seems bizarre to me that this started at a film festival in Bristol in 1989.
Yeah, it did.
Wow. I mean, again, I'm guessing, I don't know, I can't even remember. I forgot I'm thinking about dinner. But yeah, it's the film with that made Wallace and Gromit famous, and you know, obviously it went on to be a huge deal. Now I know it was in this country. I don't know how the rest of the world felt about Wallace and Gromit, but it was certainly huge over here.
Yeah, it was.
I'd for whatever reason you'd get I don't know. It was always. You'd walk down the road or you'd be stuck in traffic or whatever, and you'd see a lot of cars and vans or whatever. You'd always see Wallace and Gromit knickknacks hanging from rear view mirrors.
Yeah.
Bloody loads of them. Or even air fresheners or something. There's always Wallace and Gromit knickknacks around everywhere.
Yes.
And compared to the rest of the series of films, I have to say, A Grand Day Out does feel a little bit, it does feel a little bit like a smaller budget and a bit older, but it's still like, you know, it's cracking, little idea. I love it. It was a lot of fun. You know, it's silly, and there's something so British about it in the way that it's quaint and silly and eccentric. And I like that, you know, it's ours.
Yeah.
Love it. I think we feel protective of it, even if it's not the best thing in the world. it's had its time, essentially. They could make new ones, but it's had its time, and it peaked and everything. But it was, at the time, it was brilliant, and is as much as a part of our culture as, you know, tea and toast.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
It's really beautiful that it started that long ago. But bloody hell, does it feel that long ago as well? Now, like, really, 89?
Yeah, I mean,
that's
I thought it was
a hop, skip, and a jump to like The Wrong Trousers, which is when we were in secondary school.
93, yeah. I thought that was when it first came out. I wasn't aware of A Grand Day Out until I think after A Close Shave. I think. So.
Oh right. Okay. Right.
So, I mean, it's been a while since I've seen seen A Grand Day Out, so I need to try and find it and rewatch it. But I wrote The Wrong Trousers was hilarious.
Oh, it's bloody brilliant. It just seems so crazy that this is so long ago. It doesn't feel that old, but
no.
I think about it. We've got 1989 to secondary school is literally just such a short space of time.
Yeah.
And in that time, we really became shaped as, you know, the people we were going to be. And some of this was by some of the greatest music ever and by some of the silliest bullshit ever.
Yeah.
Like this, like A Grand Day Out, where there's a man and his anthropomorphic dog jumping a rocket to the moon.
Yeah.
And like talk about eating crackers on cheese on crackers. And, you know, it's like, what the fuck am I watching? But yeah, I was very aware of this from like quite early on for whatever reason. I don't know if,
yeah.
I don't know if I was just watching the right programs at the right time or whatever. But yeah, because it's one of the chaps from, oh, I can't remember his name, from Last of the Summer Wine.
Peter Sellers.
It is. There you go. Because yeah. My brain goes, Sellers. It's like, no, it's not Peter Sellers.
No, Peter Sellers.
Yeah. So yeah, it's just, I don't know. I guess I was watching a certain kind of programming back in the day that would mean that I was up to date on this kind of stuff.
Oh yeah. You know, and then Last of Summer Wine was a classic comedy program.
Oh well, yeah, there's that as well. Yeah, of course. Wow, okay. All around the world tonight. Lisa Stansfield.
Yes.
Yeah. I Can't Find My Baby. No. this wasn't her first song, was it? Before it, you know, she didn't hit number one with her breakout song, did she?
I am just trying to have a look. I don't think so. I think this is probably one of her better known songs. All around the world. She was first released out music in 84. Love Will Wait and Finest Things, I think, were her first two singles in 86. So yeah, definitely not. I think this may have been like her first number one. I'm just
right. So she'd been around for a while. So I did get the sensation that she had been, a recording artist for some time.
Yeah.
But I don't remember her being like, I had heard of her, but I just never. You know, kids like sensational stuff. So all of a sudden, when someone goes to number one, you're like, oh yeah. They're huge, they're massive, they're amazing. And I think I started to realise just how big a deal I think this was for Lisa Stansfield, because she'd been around for a significant amount of time without a huge hit. But I love this.
I think this was from her first actual studio album. So even though she'd released music, I don't think she'd been a commercial success until this album and this song came out. So I think potentially it could have been her official number one, the first ever number one.
Because she did like This Is the Right Time, and I can't think, was that?
Yeah, that was 89 as well. Same album.
Right. Okay. So was that before or after Been Around the World?
That was before All Around the World.
There you go. So that's the reason why. That's the reason why I was aware of her, not because young age was trawling the charts for all kinds of unknown artists or anything, but yeah, because I like This Is the Right Time. That makes sense. Oh, I like that song as well. Yeah, it's again, she was an artist of the time, though. I feel like she wasn't around for. She's still releasing music. I understand that, but she wasn't in the consciousness of the nation anymore. I don't think, was she?
No, I think she kind of disappeared around mid nineties. Sorry.
Yeah.
From what I can see, she released the album in 89, 91, 93, 97, 2001, 2004, and then there was a 10-year break. So, yeah, I mean, I would say her peak was like 89 to 93.
Yeah. Because she's a UK recording artist as well. I can't imagine, you know how sometimes American artists can kind of like hang around in the UK charts because of their cool exotic appeal, you know, how we keep saying about things like Baywatch or whatever.
Oh yes. Yeah.
It doesn't have to be good. It's American. Therefore, therefore it's not a Pebble Beach and the Antiques Roadshow, you know, all of a sudden it's like, oh, it's exciting. But I think a lot of homegrown acts do tend to vanish once, you know, they've hit their peak and it's all downhill the other side. They can disappear. So yeah, I feel like it's kind of sad, but you'll not really hear, you know, kids listening to 80s and 90s music going, you know who I love, Lisa Stansfield. You'll never ever hear that, and I think it's a bit of a shame. I'm currently going through a stage where I'm trying to find all manner of music by artists and bands that I already know, but they're songs that aren't immediately like the obvious one that you would think of, or even bands or artists that I've not heard of before. And they've had a hit. They've had a good song that's been made even better by an established act covering it. Robert Palmer did a cover of a song called "I Didn't Mean to Turn You On," which is huge. And you know, we had the best of Robert Palmer, and I've heard that a lot. It was actually by an artist called, I think it's Chanel.
Right.
And I've been listening to, you know, stuff like that recently, because I think there's so much good music that goes under the radar and out of the public consciousness that I think it's a tragedy. And I think it's worth everyone going back and trying to find stuff like this. And, you know, did you like it? If you like it, great. Add it to a playlist on your Spotify if you still got Spotify. You know, whack it on YouTube. Have some fun with it. You know, don't just when you listen to Ask Dangerous and you hear about all these number ones, you know, like Enigma, Sadness Part One. Who?
Enigma.
Who's that? What was this? Hey. So it's good to go back and listen to those. And I think that she's a really, really good example of music that shouldn't be forgotten.
Much like Erasure as well.
Right. But yeah, that's crazy. That's crazy that no one remembers that. That's really bonkers, because they had so many hits.
Oh, they did. They did.
And then Back to the Future 2, which was, it's a typical Hollywood thing where they take a great idea. It's not as a huge jump, but it is a bit different from the first film, isn't it? And I don't just mean in the fact that it's in the future, rather than the past. It's a very different film altogether, isn't it?
It is, yeah, it is. But I enjoyed the second one.
Absolutely, and it is a smashing film. It deals with some interesting ideas, like, you know, in the year 2000, we're going to be riding around in flying cars and all that. You know, Jaws number 10 or whatever it was with the giant holograms. There's some really interesting ideas. I think they thought that technology was going to pick up and go a lot faster than it actually did. It's changed. They've changed the theme from the first one. But they've tried their best, you know. They've throughout the franchise, what they do try and keep little Easter eggs and themes running. Although it's very different from the original Beautiful Baby, and, you know, with different writers who've been brought in by different executives and everything, it's still a smashing film. You remember this coming out, right? You remember the buzz around it.
Yeah, absolutely. I remember. Yeah, because the first one was so popular. The second one was just like a mass event. It was like, I want to say, I don't think it was newsworthy, but I think there was a lot of buzz around the local cinemas, and it did well in the UK, even in the US, but it did well in the UK.
Yeah. I don't know how. I don't know how it did in the US, but I think it did absolutely huge business over here. Again, we're still in that time. This is 89. We're craving bright lights. We are craving, you know, we brand new ideas and, you know, not just cool, but like, you know, get us out of this beige monstrosity that we call 1989 England. Yeah, we needed some pizzazz. And bloody hell, did this film provide it in spades? It's, you know, Michael J. Fox is a huge star. Everyone loves Christopher Lloyd. You've got the DeLorean. You've got like brightly colored clothes. You've got a film that very closely mirrors as humanly possible the first massive mega hit that was Back to the Future. And it does take the original film and kind of like, you know, pump it full of steroids.
It does.
So that it's not really the same kind. It's not the same kind of film if you peel back a few layers. Yeah. But it is smashing, and it's so much fun. And I think I can pick at it a little bit as an adult, as a grumpy asshole. But it's only just picky little bits. I'm just being facetious, really. it's still a smashing film, and we needed it. Like I said, kids, it was something to talk about. It was something to get involved with each other about, and it was so much fun.
Yeah.
Holy shit! These people's idea of what the future is going to be was just it blew our minds. What do you mean? What do you mean a giant shark hologram is going to come down and get you? Is this what it's going to be like? Flying cars? Yes, maybe it's right. And it got us excited. And even though the reality is very far away from that, and we wouldn't even be able to power these flying cars now, even if we did have them. There's lots of very lovely ideas.
Absolutely.
And so it's watching it was just an absolute pleasure, and I just remember the constant conversations I'm having with my friends about it. I think our eyes might have been bulging. We might have been salivating as we're discussing the film that we've just seen. Yes. I don't know about you. Did you get to see it at the time at the cinema?
I didn't get to see it at the cinema. No, I had to wait for it to come out on, I think it was BBC One, but I think it was like a year later. But I mean, again, it was,
wow.
I think it was still worth it, though. I remember when they did the, because the third one came out, oh man, I think the third one was like a year later. So I think BBC did like both of them at the same time or something stupid like that. So. I mean, even though there were movies I saw in the cinema, I wasn't a big guy a big kid who would go to the cinema all the time. So,
right,
I was like someone who would have to wait for it to come out on terrestrial TV. So, I do remember watching it on the TV and just loving it. So, I mean, did you get to see it in the cinema?
Yeah, I believe I did. I went to the cinema quite a lot as a kid, I feel.
Yeah.
I did get to see a lot of things. What I didn't get to see was I didn't have an extensive, I mean, I had lots of videos, but not really like hits, you know. Sure. We didn't tend to go to the shop and buy a video. We either rented it or we went to the cinema. And I can't imagine why. It seems like a bit of a crazy thing to do. Do you want to watch something once? Hell yeah. Do you want to watch it all the time? Nuh-uh, that's just crazy talk. So I don't understand what that's all about, but yeah, I was very, very lucky in that respect that I did get to go and see it. Otherwise, I think it would have been years. I probably would have been leaving secondary school by the time I see it. But the kind of person I am, like with Jumanji, I didn't see that 15 years later or whatever.
Oh, man, I didn't even see Jumanji until like 20 years later.
Oh, yeah.
Jeez. It's actually a good film, to be honest. I just remember the hype about Jumanji. And I was just like, yeah, you know what? I'm going to miss that completely. Much like Jurassic Park. It's like, no one's going to tell me to watch Jurassic Park until I'll watch it when I'm good and ready. I tell you that. Oh, dear. Jumanji, I mean, I've seen the remake of it, and it's not a patch on the original Robin Williams one. So.
No, not at all. Not at all. Absolutely bollocks, shit, fuck no. Hell no. But I speaking of remakes, I think I'd quite like to see... I would like to see a concept of a reboot or a fourth Back to the Future. I wouldn't want everyone wetting themselves over a full reboot, trilogy or something, because I'm sure there's going to be people out there going like, oh, the special effects are so much better. The new ones are definitely better than the old ones. I would have to hunt these people down and murder them in a cruel and unusual fashion. Although I'd like to see what they could do with it nowadays.
Yeah.
With improved budgets and technology, I... very, very grateful that we had this at the time. It was the right films, the right stories, the right characters at the right time.
I think you'd have to wait for Robert Zemeckis and Bob Gale to pass away before that happens, because I know that they already said they would not do a Back to the Future 4. So,
well, I hope that by the time they do sadly leave us, I hope people just go nah.
Yeah. Can't be
bothered.
Yeah,
like they just leave it well alone and love it for what it is.
Absolutely. Right. I'm sure we'll cover the trilogy one day on the show at some stage as well. So
absolutely.
Excellent. So shall we move on to Quotely 90s?
Let's do it.
Okay, no more retro journalistic joy for you lot this week. That's your lot. We'll be back real soon, right after the break.
Hey there, guys and dames, it's Andrew and Brandon from Namely 90s, your brother horseman in this retro apocalypse.
Today we have a little quiz for you, a memory game, if you will, that Gaz has brilliantly named Quotely 90s.
Each week we'll send you a quote and see if you can guess its origin from some piece of pop culture in the 1990s.
Just remember, our worlds weren't as interconnected then, since we lived across the pond and the internet still ran at 26 kilobits per second.
We'll also, for our own amusement, do multiple readings and either do poor imitations of the character slash person who said it, or just poor imitations of whomever we feel like.
And if you're lucky, you'll hear Andrew slip into his terribly offensive English accent.
Well, is that enough of a setup for you lads? Are you ready for Quotely 90s? Name the movie and, if possible, the character who said this. Bonus points for the actor. They'll print anything these days.
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 Don't print anything these days.
Don't print anything these days.
Oh, they're really, really... Ooh. That's not a lot to go on, is it?
No.
Ooh, I mean, I feel like... trying to think of films to do with newspapers, and the only one that I can think of is The World Is Not Enough. Is that it?
James Bond.
Yeah. I'm just trying to think if that's... Yeah, it's about the
Tomorrow Never Dies?
Hmm?
Is it Tomorrow Never Dies or World Is Not
Enough? Yeah, I don't know. I was going to say, I'm about to Google it, but that's...
You can't.
Face the pipes. Okay, right. Okay.
But you want to say it's a James Bond movie.
I do. I mean, I was thinking that's only because it's the only film that I can think of that has a newspaper in it that I can think now off the top of my head. And then I feel like I heard Mr. Brandon Meat.
Yes.
That doesn't mean anything to anyone on this show, does it? I forgot about that. Brandon Meat and Andrew Loaf. It makes sense if you... It makes sense, I promise. You have to listen to Namely 90s. I'm pretty sure I heard a something that sounded a bit like a Sean Connery impression.
Yeah.
So although it's not a Sean Connery film, maybe... I don't know.
Well, we've got the actor, right? Well, we've got the Pierce Brosnan James Bond one. We're just not sure of the actual movie. released in the 90s. shall we find out? Shall we ask?
Yeah, I think we're going to have to. Unless you've got something.
No, I mean, I think you're right. I think it is James Bond, but I'm just not sure of which movie it was.
Okay. All right. Let's have a listen then.
Backseat Driver. 'Tis from the Time Lord and MI6 agent himself, James Bond, played by Pierce Brosnan in Tomorrow Never Dies.
Brandon watched this recently for another podcast and determined 95% of Brosnan's lines are quips in this film.
And if you're interested in hearing more about Tomorrow Never Dies, we discuss it further on next Monday's December 1997 episode of Namely 90s.
Find it on your platform of choice at namely90s.com/listen. Now back to the perpetually quippy, insanely dangerous Gaz and Dange.
Yes. Yes. We love
do like a good quip.
unless it's in a Marvel film, then there's too many of them.
Too many quips. Yeah.
Too many quips. The sky is falling down and people are exploding and children are crying. It's like, whoop, this looks like a bad day at the office. No. How dare you? Too many quips.
oh, dear.
But if it's James Bond, totally allowed.
Yeah.
Totally allowed.
We got the actor and the name of the character, right? We just weren't sure on the actual movie. So
that's it. There you go. And it was Tomorrow Never Dies. But if I tell
pod fans, if anyone can think of a, or just research, you don't have to guess. You are allowed to use the internet. We're not here.
Yes.
If you can think of another film that has, not just from the 90s either, 80s and 90s, if you can think of another film that actually is the, has, just put my bloody tongue back in. If you can think of a film from the 80s and 90s that features a newspaper, we want to know. Not because it's terribly interesting, but just so I can go to sleep at night, not to think about it. Yes. And I have dinner to cook now, so I can't then sit down after the show and Google endlessly. I actually have to go and be a parent and
cook
my child some food, because I seem to have neglected to do that.
Oh, dear. Well, let's just get the end of the show over with then. Get it over with quickly.
Oh, yes, actually. And but I will say this, but before we shoot off, if you do prefer your retro with a bit more of a 90s flavour, then you need to check out Quotely, not Quotely 90s, namely 90s. Ooh, man, I can't wait for the end of the show so I can stop thinking. If you go check out Namely 90s, they're absolutely fantastic, really insightful, funny, and don't waffle half as much, and also won't go nearly as much as I do.
Excellent.
And they're not insanely quippy.
No.
They don't like a cliche or a quip quite as much as we do. So thank you, lads. We really appreciate everything that you do for us, and it's always great to link up. And so if you wanted to understand the Brandon Meat and Andrew Loaf joke, we occasionally help out with the show, so go on over and see if you can find the episode where that's relevant. But I will let Dangerous go, and I'll let Producer Buddy go, and I will feed my child.
Yes.
Anything interesting?
I've got a meeting tomorrow to discuss having a Baywatch reboot. So yourself and you and me as the main characters. So that'll be interesting. Oh. Going to get to speak to the Hoff.
Oh, who's going to replace the Hoff though? Because he's pushing 80. He doesn't want to be running down the beach.
He's pushing 80. Yeah,
he'll get down to the other end of the beach. He's like, what am I doing here?
Well, I think you and I are going to have to audition to see who is going to be the Hoff.
Oh, right. I meant that. What, out of you and I?
Yeah, we're going to have to hoff off. We're going to have to hoff off. Oh, dear.
Oh, dear. I'm not sure if it's like because I'm mentally impaired right now, but that was really funny. We'll have a hoff off.
Hoff off.
Brilliant.
Excellent. And next week's show, we're going to talk about Superman 4. Yes.
Superman 4. I feel like a lot of these subjects recently are just like, this is just coming straight off your wish list.
It is indeed, yes.
Oh, absolutely. Dear. Oh, and if you could hear that in the background, pod fans, that's my alarm saying the dinner is burning.
Right. So, okay.
Please come back next week where you won't hear an alarm for dinner, but you will get to hear about Superman 4. Thank you very much, Dane, for all your help. You're amazing. And I think it's about this time of the show where I let the outro do the talking.
Okay, Insaniacs and Dangerheads, that's us all done for another week. Time for Danger myself to leave you in our rearview mirror like a real-life outrun. Don't forget to contact the show for a chance to win some goodies, and make sure you tune in next week for more retro radness. Until then, you stay frosty.